Welcome to the first episode of Night Train to Mondo Cine. I'm your host, Dave Wilt, back on YouTube after a few years. If you're one of my subscribers, you probably thought I was dead. If you are new to my channel, you probably never knew I was alive in the first place. Anyway, this new series will contain a rather eclectic mix of pop culture topics, from international cinema to comic books, propaganda, cult movies, and who knows what else. Hopefully you'll find some of these topics interesting and you'll check back in for new episodes. So thanks for watching. The first several episodes of Night Train to Mondo Cine will deal with the life and career of actor Carlos Villarías, best known today for starring in the 1931 Spanish-language version of Dracula. For many years, he was mostly a footnote in film history until the restoration and video release of Dracula in 1992, prompted in no small part by David J. Scahl's 1990 book Hollywood Gothic. With the VHS and then DVD and Blu-ray releases of this film, Villarías has subsequently become a sort of cult figure, particularly for Latin Americans and Spaniards. As a horror movie fan, I was aware of Villarías, and I also knew he'd appeared in a number of Mexican movies. But while I'd read a lot about Bela Lugosi, I knew very little about Carlos Villarías. There are some similarities between the two men. They were roughly the same age. Both were performers who emigrated to the United States from Europe. Their work in the 1931 film versions of Dracula was arguably the high point of their careers, or at least it's what they're mostly remembered for. Their acting careers both ceased in the 1950s. Although Villarías outlived Lugosi by 20 years, there is no evidence he continued to work as an actor. But despite these possibly coincidental similarities, as it turns out, the life and career of Carlos Villarías, the Spanish Dracula, was very different than I had imagined. And that's what the first episodes of Night Train to Mondo Cine will examine. The biographical information about Carlos Villarías in both English and Spanish language sources contains many contradictions and inaccuracies. Some of the confusing data comes from notoriously inaccurate press releases and even from Villarías himself. It's hardly unusual for performers to pad their resumes or embellish their life stories. One thing we can be fairly sure of is that Carlos Fermín Villarías Llano was born in the city of Córdoba in the Andalusia region of Spain on the 7th of July. However, the year of his birth is one of those ambiguous facts made more so by Villarías himself. Like many performers, he often claimed he was younger than he actually was, perhaps for career purposes. Villarías appears to have been sensitive about his age. In January 1931, he told Fidel Murillo of the Los Angeles newspaper La Opinión that he, quote, lamented the fact that there aren't enough old actors in the film industry because it obliged him to play such characters when he's still in the flower of youth. He was actually in his mid-40s at the time. July 7, 1884 is the date that appears to have the most validity, as it shows up in early references before Villarías, for personal and professional purposes, started shaving years off his age, even on official documents. A column written by Miguel de Zárraga that appeared in the Manila newspaper La Voz Española in 1931 claims Villarías, quote, still hasn't reached the age of 30. De Zárraga was a journalist and writer who worked on a number of Spanish-language feature films made in Hollywood, including at least five with Carlos Villarías. So in this highly favorable article, he was probably just doing his friend a favor by knocking a decade and a half off his age. One possible check on Villarías' actual age are the earliest accounts I have found of his singing career, two appearances in Paris in December 1910. The Paris newspaper Le Radical reported that Carlos Villarías was among the performers at a festive meeting of the, quote, Parisian section of the Federation of Secular Youth of France, held in the Salons Ludo on the 17th of December, 1910. The article remarked, quote, a concert followed and allowed us to applaud foreign and French artists of a real talent. We will cite, among others, Messieurs Villarías, Luis Molsnat, Díaz de Villabella, and Gaston Secretan. A 31st of December 1910 newspaper article in the Heraldo de Madrid describes a different performance in Paris held at the Gaveau Concert Hall and featuring artists from the Paris Opera, the Comic Opera, La Scala, and the Orchestre Lamoureux, in which, quote, the Spanish singer Carlos Villarías made a loud triumph singing the bass part of the first act of Resurrezione, a 1904 opera. Quote, Señor Villarías was applauded and congratulated by the distinguished audience. So if Carlos Villarías was born in 1892, he would have been 18 years old when he did this, which is possible but not particularly likely. If he was born in 1895, he'd have been singing in Paris at the age of 15. Some sources claim Villarías was sent to Paris by his father to improve his language abilities, and while there decided to study music instead. And in fact, Villarías was living in Milan, Italy, when he immigrated to the USA in 1915. So it is conceivable he first went to France and then to Italy to study opera, but this is only speculation. We can speak with somewhat more authority on the family of Carlos Villarías. He was the son of Don José Villarías y Vinuesa, born in Madrid on the 2nd of January, 1843. Don José joined the Spanish army in September 1862 and retired in January 1905 at the rank of Comisario de Guerra Primera Clase. His wife and the mother of Carlos Villarías was Doña Emilia Llano Flores García. Don José and Doña Emilia had three sons, of which Carlos was the third and youngest. According to his obituary in March 1932, José Villarías Llano was 62 years old at the time he died. José was a lawyer and a longtime civil servant in the Ministry of Public Instruction and Fine Arts. He also co-authored a book on the province of Valladolid. Emilio Villarías Llano, the second son, born on the 20th of June, 1872, followed in his father's footsteps. He entered Spain's military academy in June 1891 and joined the Spanish army in May 1893, eventually rising to the rank of lieutenant colonel. So Carlos Villarías came from a fairly distinguished family, and his older brothers both had successful professional careers. Some sources claim Villarías himself earned a law degree, which isn't entirely illogical considering his brother José was a successful lawyer, but there doesn't seem to be hard documentation that Carlos suddenly abandoned the practice of law for the stage. In any case, we do have those newspaper articles identifying him as an opera singer in 1910 in Paris, so it does seem he had chosen to become a performer rather than a lawyer or a military officer like his older brothers. There is one mysterious piece of documentation indicating a Don Carlos Villarías traveled from Italy to Boston in 1911 on the SS Romanic. The Romanic made regular runs from Boston to the Mediterranean and back again from January to November 1911, carrying large numbers of immigrants, mostly from Italy. However, Villarías in later years on various government documents attested that he first arrived in the USA in March 1915, for which we have ample proof. It is possible he visited the United States in 1911 and returned to Europe, or it was some other Don Carlos Villarías, or who knows. Villarías left Genoa, Italy on the 20th of February 1915 on the White Star liner SS Canopic. He was one of 194 second-class passengers and one of 50 who continued on to the ship's final destination, New York City. After stops in Naples, Palermo, Gibraltar, and the Azores, the ship docked in Boston on the 10th of March 1915. Villarías gave immigration officials his previous residence as Milan, Italy, and listed his father, then resident in Valladolid, as his next of kin. His profession was artiste. Why did Carlos Villarías leave Italy for the New World? World War I had broken out in the summer of 1914. Italy resigned from the Triple Alliance and declared itself neutral, but in May 1915 joined the Allied forces against Germany and Austro-Hungary. France was heavily involved in the war, of course, but it's unclear if Villarías left Europe specifically because of the conflict. Some later articles about Villarías, possibly based on a 1949 interview with Camera magazine, indicate World War I hampered his operatic job prospects, and this, plus a reference to a love affair gone wrong, led to his decision to emigrate. Did he have a solid job offer in the USA, or perhaps just a letter of introduction? He did find work fairly quickly. Carlos Villarías was announced as a member of the San Carlo Opera Company as early as the 28th of March 1915, less than 3 weeks after his arrival in the country. The San Carlo Opera Company was founded by Italian immigrant Fortuné Gallo to tour the USA presenting opera to towns and cities overlooked by the famous opera companies such as the Metropolitan Opera. It appears Carlos Villarías replaced Emilio Cesona as a basso in the opera company at the end of March, possibly in time for the troops' return engagement at the Belasco Theater in Washington, D.C. However, Villarías was definitely in the cast when the San Carlo played the Nixon Theater in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, during the week of April 18th. The San Carlo Opera Company put on 7 performances in 6 days, including a matinee and an evening performance on Wednesday, and Villarías was scheduled to sing in 6 of them. He earned his first American review for a role in Bizet's Carmen, with Villarías, one of those noted in the Pittsburgh Post-Gazette as being good in other principal roles. However, the following week's booking in Philadelphia was canceled due to the impressionistic finances of the San Carlo Opera Company, as a Philadelphia newspaper put it. It was later reported that the company had gone bankrupt with the artists unpaid. This was unfortunately to be repeated several times in the opera career of Carlos Villarías. What was Carlos Villarías doing for the rest of 1915, and as it develops, most of 1916? Presumably he found work somewhere, but no trace of it has been found thus far. In fact, the only activity which can definitely be attributed to Carlos Villarías for the entire year of 1916 is, as it develops, his first brush with motion pictures. Villarías appeared in the short film El Pobre Valbuena, filmed in 1916 in New York. The director and co-star was Manuel Noriega. It's unclear when Villarías first met Noriega, but they would be associated on various projects in New York, Hollywood, and Mexico for more than 30 years. Manuel Noriega Ruiz was born in Madrid, Spain on the 26th of April, 1880. He became an actor, particularly in the Spanish género chico, and traveled around Latin America during the first decades of the 20th century. In 1906 or 1907, Noriega directed a short film comedy in Mexico titled El San Lunes del Valedor. Noriega hit the road once more and in May 1916 arrived in New York from Havana on the SS Saratoga. In September, Noriega was described as the actor-manager of the Spanish Theater, which was to perform a weekly variety show on Saturday evenings at the Amsterdam Opera House on West 44th Street in New York City. Although the only names mentioned in newspaper accounts were star Maria Conesa and Noriega himself, one assumes Carlos Villarías had some role in this project, since it was apparently in this period that Noriega also began shooting the film adaptation of the 1904 Spanish comedy El Pobre Valbuena under the banner of Noriega Film. An advertisement in Cine Mundial in November 1916 indicated a version of El Puñado de Rosas was also made, but it's unclear if this was ever completed or shown. A 1949 issue of Camera magazine features a photo, presumably supplied by Villarías, which shows him and several other actors, one of whom is Manuel Noriega, in another film or possibly a stage act. Since Villarías is dressed like a minister, it's clearly not a still from El Pobre Valbuena. Parts of El Pobre Valbuena were apparently shot at the former Biograph Studios, located at 807 East 175th Street in the Bronx, while locations in Brooklyn, including Coney Island, were also used. Maria Conesa and Noriega both appeared, and a cast photo unmistakably shows Carlos Villarías as well. He played Pepe el Tranquilo. Aside from Conesa, Noriega, Villarías, and Etelvina Rodriguez, the rest of the cast, made up primarily of Spaniards resident in New York, appeared in few, if any, other films. Ironically, considering the abrupt ending of the San Carlo Opera Company's season while Villarías was employed there, El Pobre Valbuena, a medium-length film lasting between 30 and 40 minutes, also ran into problems. Star Maria Conesa later complained that the film was an informal rehearsal, that she was never paid for her appearance, and never thought the film would be shown commercially. It's unclear if she actually took legal action against Noriega Film or merely complained to the press. In any case, El Pobre Valbuena appears to be a lost film. More than 20 years after the filming of El Pobre Valbuena in New York, Carlos Villarías would perform in a live version of the zarzuela in June 1937 at the Teatro California in Los Angeles as a benefit for the Artistas Unidos group. 1917 is another year in which the activities of Carlos Villarías are not well documented. It's possible he appeared in some weekly shows produced by Manuel Noriega. We do know that he had recording sessions with Columbia in March and September. Columbia Records was one of three major phonograph cylinder and then record producers in the USA in the early years of the 20th century, along with Edison and Victor. In 1908, Columbia began to produce records in Spanish, and by 1914 had hundreds, if not thousands, of such titles in its catalog. Villarías made at least a dozen recordings for Columbia, both as a solo artist and as a member of a trio and a quartet. He sang popular songs like La Cucaracha and La Golondrina. the national anthems of Mexico and Venezuela, and songs from Spanish zarzuelas. Villarías returned to the recording studios in 1918, this time for Edison, in various sessions from March through August, producing at least a dozen records. For Edison, Villarías sang solo or in a duet with a female soprano, including Emilia Vergeri. Many of the songs were from operettas, operas, or zarzuelas, a somewhat more upscale repertoire than the Columbia records, which appear to have been aimed particularly at Mexican or Mexican-American consumers. In addition to his recording dates, Carlos Villarías sang at the National Opera Club of America's annual evening of Grand Opera in January 1918. Manuel Noriega's theatrical company was still in business, performing weekly at New York's Amsterdam Opera House throughout the year and into 1919. There are no press mentions of Villarías participating in these shows, but it's certainly possible, although by the fall of 1918, he had found other employment. In September 1918, with the United States actively involved in World War I, Carlos Villarías registered for the U.S. military draft, giving his address as 316 West 51st Street in the working-class Hell's Kitchen neighborhood of New York City. His occupation is singer and his employer as the Creatore Grand Opera Company. Italian bandleader Giuseppe Creatore, known as the Great Creatore, formed his touring opera company in 1917. Carlos Villarías appeared as Fernando in Il Trovatore at Philadelphia's Metropolitan Opera House in a Columbus Day celebration on the 12th of October 1918. The Creatore Company's 1918-1919 tour ran 20 weeks and played large and small cities, including Reading, York, and Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, Baltimore, Maryland, Akron, Ohio, etc. However, it's unclear how long Carlos Villarías was with Creatore. His name is not mentioned in newspaper articles or advertisements again, and we know he left the USA to take a position with the Mancini Grand Opera Company in February 1919. Americo Mancini's Mancini Grand Opera Company had been in existence for a number of years, presenting grand opera in the southern USA, the Caribbean, and South America. Carlos Villarías left New York on the SS Caracas on the 19th of February, 1919, arriving in San Juan, Puerto Rico, 5 days later. One of the featured singers in the Mancini Company was Emilia Vergeri, who had partnered with Villarías on several Edison records the previous year. Over the next several months, Villarías appeared in Puerto Rico, the Dominican Republic, and possibly Havana, Cuba. Some shows in April 1919 were described as being presented by a variety company directed by Maestro Torres, featuring singer Enriqueta Witz and Villarías, which suggests these shows may have been done by members of the Mancini Company on their own accord. Villarías receives positive mentions in the Puerto Rican newspaper El Imparcial, with one article mentioning Villarías, whose manner of singing we have all admired. The next stop on the tour was to be Venezuela, but Villarías was no longer with the company, having departed for New York on the SS Leopoldina on the 8th of May. Baritone Vicente Ballester and tenor Ricardo Martin had also left Mancini in April and May, respectively. It appears there were financial and management issues, and the Mancini Grand Opera Company soon folded up shop. Fortunately, Carlos Villarías was not at liberty for long, joining the Spanish Opera Company in New York. This appears to have been the successor to Manuel Noriega's short-lived Spanish Theater Company, which staged the opera Marusha in April 1919, but went under when the show's musicians went on strike. The Spanish Opera Company, announced in June, was managed by Leoncio Mosquera, although Manuel Noriega was part of the company, as was Carlos Villarías. Popular singer Adelina Vecchi was perhaps the company's biggest name star. Mosquera indicated a Spanish-language version of The Merry Widow would be the first production, but producer Henry Savage, who owned the performance rights to the light opera, successfully sued to prevent this. A new program was quickly arranged, The Old Lady and Dreams of Three, two short musical plays, opened at the Court Theater in July 1919. The Old Lady, or La Viejecita, was a one-act musical about a captain of dragoons, played by actress Consuelo Bayo, who impersonates an older woman so he can meet his sweetheart. Carlos Villarías played the supporting role of Fernando. Dreams of Three is a one-act play in five scenes featuring stories of three different painters, a Spaniard, a Frenchman, and an Italian. Villarías played the Italian artist, and the Billboard review of the show said Villarías, an excellent comedian in any language, sang effectively. Although The Old Lady and Dreams of Three were well received, the show closed on the 26th of July after 16 performances. Several additional musical plays were attempted, but the company eventually disbanded. Despite the collapse of the Spanish theater and the Spanish Opera Company, Manuel Noriega and some of his Spanish compatriots tried once again, forming the Sociedad Artística Española, which performed variety shows at the Amsterdam Opera House, the Park Theater, and Proctor's Theater Palm Garden in October 1919. In addition to Noriega, the actors included singer Dora Iris, Pepe Luis, and the galán joven, or young leading man, Carlos Villarías. We hear nothing more of Carlos Villarías until the 20th of July 1921, when he left New York on the SS Saxonia to return to Spain. He came back to the USA on the SS Montserrat in September. Villarías had listed his mother Emilia as his next of kin on his 1918 draft registration, and since he still lists his mother as next of kin when he arrived back in the USA in September, his trip home was not to attend her funeral or anything of the sort. Perhaps it was just a visit after 6 years in the New World. Also with Villarías on the SS Montserrat when it docked in New York were composer Manuel Pineda Moreno and 16-year-old Concepcion Piquer López, later known as Concha Piquer. Pineda had written the music for Dreams of Three, but more importantly, he was the author of El Gato Montes, which would soon be produced on stage in New York as The Wild Cat, and which would be the next project of Carlos Villarías. Producer John Court, with the financial backing of violinist Ephraim Zimbalist and his wife, singer Alma Gluck, purchased the rights to Panea's popular 1916 work and had it adapted for an English-speaking audience. The Wild Cat featured American actors in major roles, with a handful of actual Spaniards providing support and authenticity. Among the Spanish performers in The Wild Cat was Carlos Villarías. Rehearsals began in early November, and The Wild Cat opened at the Park Theater in New York on the 26th of November, 1921, to generally positive reviews and apparently good box office. Carlos Villarías, born in Andalusia, where El Gato Montes was set, was cast as Hormigón, the picador friend of bullfighter Rafael. The Wild Cat closed on the 28th of January, 1922, after 74 performances, and almost immediately went on the road, opening in Baltimore 2 days later. However, although most of the original cast was retained for the tour, for unknown reasons, Carlos Villarías was not in the roadshow company. He was replaced in the role of Hormigón by Wilfred Glenn, a prolific recording artist with little stage experience. Panea's work was filmed in 1924 in Hollywood under the evocative title Tiger Love, coincidentally directed by George Melford, who would later direct Villarías in Dracula in the fall of 1930. The star of the film was Antonio Moreno, who would work with Villarías in half a dozen Hollywood films of the 1930s. In May 1922, Carlos Villarías is credited for roles in the operas Aida and Carmen, performed at the Brooklyn Academy of Music. In the fall of 1923, Villarías appeared as part of a traveling vaudeville troupe presenting scenes and songs from various operas. The troupe was organized by Madame Doré, a former New York socialite who in 1913 created an act in which famous opera stars such as Enrico Caruso were impersonated and depicted in scenes from their signature roles. Carlos Villarías was part of the Madame Doré troupe in November 1923. His presence cannot be verified any earlier or later, although the act continued to be presented until at least 1926. He was mentioned rather prominently in the publicity, variously credited as being a former member of the Milan Opera and the Spanish Grand Opera of Madrid. However, after November, Villarías is not included in any of Madame Doré's publicity, and one assumes he was no longer with the act. Could film acting in New York account for some of the gaps in the resume of Carlos Villarías prior to 1927? When he returned to Spain early in 1949, Villarías told the movie magazine Camera that he had appeared in numerous silent movies in the 1920s. Villarías said he'd worked with directors including D.W. Griffith and J. Stuart Blackton, and performers such as Geraldine Farrar, Rod LaRocque, Pauline Frederick, and Gloria Swanson. He even cited two film titles, Notoriety with Rod LaRocque and Vilma Bankey, and Foreign Legion with Gloria Swanson. Notoriety, directed by William Nye, was made in 1922. Rod LaRocque did star, but his leading lady was Maureen Powers, the wife of the director, not Vilma Bankey. However, Villarías can be forgiven for this lapse of memory, since Bankey later married Rod LaRocque. Notoriety, unfortunately, isn't readily available to screen to determine if Villarías can be identified or not. Foreign Legion with Gloria Swanson actually refers to Wages of Virtue, shot in 1924 at the Paramount Studios in Astoria, Long Island. Although this seems to be a lost film, one lobby card does feature a foreign legionnaire who, in profile, bears a distinct resemblance to Carlos Villarías. So we'll count this as a probable. Another possible Villarías film is Let Not Man Put Asunder, shot at the Biograph Studios in the fall of 1923. It was directed by J. Stuart Blackton and starred Pauline Frederick, both names mentioned by Villarías in the 1949 Camera interview. Frederick's co-star was Lou Teligan, an actor whose name crops up in other Villarías articles. Sadly, this is yet another lost American silent film, one of over 7,000, so we can only speculate as to whether Carlos Villarías was in it or not. From 1916 to 1923, Teligan had been married to another performer mentioned by Villarías, opera star Geraldine Farrar. Farrar starred in more than a dozen films herself between 1915 and 1920, at least two of which were shot in the New York area. 1919's The Stronger Vow, filmed in New Jersey, and The Riddle, Woman, partially shot at the former Thanhouser Company studio in New Rochelle, New York. Both of these are considered lost films, so it's difficult to prove or disprove the presence of Villarías in either. The Woman and the Puppet, probably shot in 1919 and released in the spring of 1920, is another possibility. Farrar and Teligan co-starred in this adaptation of a French novel set in Spain. Although Farrar was a huge star and Carlos Villarías a relative unknown, they were both part of the opera world, and it's possible Farrar, who produced the movie through her own company Diva Pictures, put in a good word for Villarías. The Woman and the Puppet is, unlike most of the films just mentioned, still in existence, but is not readily available for screening. Another name cited in the Camera article is director D.W. Griffith. Griffith had left Hollywood and set up his own studio in Mamaroneck, Long Island in 1919. He spent 5 years making films there, with occasional forays to Florida and other locations. Griffith also made 3 films at the Astoria Studio in 1925-26. There are thus at least 10 Griffith-directed feature films in which Carlos Villarías could have appeared. The fact that motion picture acting was a significant focus for Carlos Villarías in this period is confirmed by his listing in the February 1925 Standard Casting Directory. As Charles Villarías, he is listed in the New York Department Heavy Men section, referring to actors who could play heavies, not their physical stature. It's unknown when Carlos Villarías relocated from New York to California, but by June 1927, he was listed as one of the artists at a benefit performance held at the Figueroa Playhouse in Los Angeles, California. Other performers included Spanish actress Rosita Moreno, who would later appear with Villarías in at least 5 Spanish-language films shot in Hollywood. In the fall of 1927, Carlos Villarías seems to have briefly been a member of the Long Beach Opera Company. The company was founded in April 1927 by voice teacher Guido Casalotti, whose daughter Adriana would go on to provide the voice for Snow White in the 1937 Walt Disney feature-length cartoon. It appears this group was largely composed of Casalotti students in Los Angeles and Long Beach and other interested amateurs. They appeared a number of times on local radio before making their live debut in September. Casalotti's star pupils also presented a live musical prologue to the film Loves of Carmen at the Carthay Circle Cinema with Carlos Villarías in the role of Zuniga. This rather fleeting and probably not very lucrative position may have been the stepping stone to his appearance in what was undoubtedly the longest and most successful show with which he had been affiliated, the West Coast presentation of The Desert Song. Sigmund Romberg's operetta The Desert Song debuted on Broadway in 1926 and ran for over a year. Rights for regional versions were sold to impresarios, and in October 1927, producer Lillian Albertson announced that she had purchased the West Coast franchise. Rehearsals began in November, and the show opened at the Windsor Square Theater in Los Angeles on the 29th of December, 1927. The show was an immediate success, and after 3 weeks it moved downtown to the Mason Theater. The Desert Song then went on the road to San Francisco, Stockton, Fresno, Marysville, and Sacramento before returning to Los Angeles, this time at the Majestic Theater, from June until November 1928. From November 1928 until the end of June 1929, the Desert Song played dates in California, Arizona, Texas, New Mexico, Utah, Idaho, Washington, Montana, North Dakota, and Oregon, as well as Vancouver, Victoria, Winnipeg, Calgary, and Edmonton, Canada. Many of these were literally one-night stands, and at the end of the long, grueling tour, producer Albertson lauded the cast and crew, stating they'd had only 1 week's vacation during the entire run. It might be noted that the film adaptation of The Desert Song premiered in April 1928, providing direct competition for the live version. Carlos Villarías, billed as Charles Villar, was originally cast in the small supporting part of Sergeant de Boussac, but in October 1928, he replaced Lionel Brom in the much more substantial role of Ali Ben Ali. Once he ascended to the role of Ali Ben Ali, Villarías did receive some additional publicity, although as usual, it was mostly press agent fiction. Quote, Charles Villar has appeared as the Jewish rabbi in Abie's Irish Rose. He was born in Morocco. His last appearance in a musical play was in Castles in the Air. The Abie's Irish Rose bit is probably completely made up to provide an ironic counterpoint to the role of Ali Ben Ali, and Villarías was certainly not born in Morocco. Castles in the Air ran on Broadway from September 1926 to January 1927, but there is no indication Villarías or even Charles Villar was in the cast of this show. It's unknown how much Villarías was paid for his role in The Desert Song, although an extant contract for John Merkel, who played another significant supporting part, General Birabeau, indicates he received $150 a week for his work on The Desert Song. It's unclear exactly what Carlos Villarías did between the conclusion of The Desert Song in the summer of 1929 and March 1930, when he began to act in Hollywood films, but at some point in this period, his career took a major turn. From his arrival in the USA in March 1915, Villarías seems to have considered himself first and foremost a singer who performed in operas, in zarzuelas, in vaudeville, and in the operetta The Desert Song, taking occasional bit parts in films to pay the bills when singing work was scarce. Beginning in 1930, Villarías rather suddenly became a dramatic actor in the cinema, a profession he exercised for the next 20 years. Was this a conscious decision? Did he dream of someday reviving his singing career? Whatever the impetus for this life change, Villarías would soon make the film that made him a celebrity for a time and which remains the film role for which he is most remembered internationally. Next time on Night Train to Mondo Cine, Carlos Villarías becoming Dracula.